Hello and welcome to a very special edition of SEABL TV this week as we reach the halfway point of the season heading into the Queen's Birthday long weekend. I am joined today by special guest Rohan Short, who is here to give us the lowdown on all of the teams to date. Welcome, Rohan.
Thank you, Beth.
We're going to get pretty stuck into the teams, starting with the East Conference today. Now, you've given the team some rankings, so we're going to go through those rankings team by team, starting with your worst ranked team for the East Conference so far. And you've told me before that your worst ranked team for the East Conference, currently sitting in sixth place on the ladder, is the Albury Wodonga Bandits. Tell us about why you've ranked them the worst so far.
Yeah, I think I probably just expected a little bit more from Albury this year, given the fact that last year there was coming off the back of that championship year, they had some injuries to some key personnel that really hindered the progress of this season. But we're just seeing no progress, and news obviously this week that Momo has decided to leave the club, and that just puts another massive dent in Albury's plans. And I suppose the question is now, where do they go? So for this season so far, I've given them a D because I think that they've gone completely backwards on where they were last year.
I think that the injury to Momo is really paramount to how their season has gone. He's not the same calibre of player that we saw in the 2012 championship. Since coming back from surgery last year, he really has struggled this season so far, and him departing the club is a loss for them, and they will find that hard to fill.
Yeah, and they just can't defend. That's the next thing. They don't have the personnel on the floor, or there's just that inner fortitude that they had a couple of years back where they were really going to push teams around, and they're going to toughen up if they're going to turn their season around.
Well, the next team we have just above Albury that you've rated quite low on your scale as well, we move on to the Brisbane Spartans, who went 0-2 in their weekend, just gone losing to both Dandenong and Geelong.
Yeah, I mean, the reason why for such a low grading here, I've given them a D as well, is the fact that I don't know what the identity of this team is. They're completely inconsistent. I mean, I recognise that Brendan Tees is only 5 games in with the club, but it just seems to me that there's just not the chemistry in this team. When you look down on paper, this team has got some amazing amount of talent. And, look, I know that Brendan Tees has come in. He had his first big game against Geelong on the weekend, but there's a lot riding on his addition into the squad. I mean, we're talking about Scott Kenny, who's now 26 of 81 from the threes this year. I mean, previous season, he was 41%. So, his time in the NBL, you would hope that these guys would resonate and blip on the radar and start to kick on, but just he hasn't done so. And turnovers, they're the second highest turnover team in the league, and that can't continue if they're going to make a push for postseason action.
Well, it's seems, and it was talked about at the start of the season with the addition of CJ Massengale into this team. So you've got Massengale, Kenny and Tees. There was talk about will there be enough ball to go around, and it seems to me that whenever one of those guys don't play is when the other two really step up. So is there enough room for all three players on that team?
Yeah, and like I said, some dysfunction either internally within their team or in the balance or composition of their team. I just can't quite put a finger on it, but they could have been right up the top this year to start with, and now they've dropped a few games. It's really going to hurt them down the line, especially when home court advantage in Brisbane is such a huge asset to them as a group.
Well, moving on to the next team, moving up the list now, we move on to the Knox Raiders, who are currently sitting in seventh place.
Yeah, I've given them a D as well, and basically because, once again, I feel like progress just hasn't been made on the season prior. They've had to go back, they've had to rebuild, they had to start late, they had some financial troubles, and we've put all those excuses out there, but at the end of the day, that group's got to perform. And, now we're seeing the coach, Matt Shanahan, suit up for their team to hopefully resurrect something. I mean, it just poses the question whether that's the right answer. I don't know, but for me, they just don't have enough contributors right now to beat the better teams. And only 3 wins on the board. This is a team that's just mellowing down the bottom, not moving very far forward quickly.
Well, again, they seem to be a team that looks a lot better on paper than they do. They've got Rhys Carter, Adam Doyle, who had a couple of really great games to start off his season in the SEABL, and he's really dropped off in the last couple of weeks. He went 0-4 from the 3-point line this past weekend, scoring only 3 points in the game. I think they really need to be more effective in their scoring options.
Yeah, and Doyle, he needs to learn how to run his team. He's got some guys there. I mean, Carter has to come in and play those sorts of minutes. You've got big Justin Brown there, and I just feel like Doyle doesn't quite know how he wants to play. Does he want to be a pass-first guy, shoot-first guy, fast-break guy, defender guy? I'm not quite sure he's exactly confident with his particular role, but I know it's something Coach Shanahan would be working with him. Maybe that's the reason why he's donned the colours and got on the floor.
So moving down the list now as we head into the Basketball Australia Centre of Excellence team. And the kids have had, you know, they've only had 2 wins for the year and 13 losses, but they've been pretty impressive in some of those losses and, of course, their wins.
Yeah, look, I got a glimpse of them when we went recently on their third game of their road trip here in Melbourne against the Nutterwood Inspectors. And I was just delighted to see Jackson McVeigh doing what he does best. I mean, previously he's looking for Dante Exum, and now Dante Exum's suddenly not there. We played school ball with him as well, and now he's the man and gets the call up to the Boomers. So I've been really impressed with that kid. I think he's been a massive, you know, exciting aspect to the Centre of Excellence in the SEABL this year.
One of the other standout players for me so far has been Xavier Cooks, who's really stepped up in the absence of some of the players when they were called up for under 17 duties, and with Jack McVeigh out with the Boomers, he's really been doing really well in both points and rebounds in leading that team.
Yeah, and seeing the Centre of Excellence back in the competition this year, their season's done now. They've played everyone once, so we won't see them for the rest of the year. But I just want to reiterate, Joe Ingles previously on the show always said that one of the things that made him great as an athlete was the fact that he could go against men in the SEABL, and we want to continue to see the Centre of Excellence in this competition moving forward.
Moving up the list now as we move on to the Nunawat Inspectors.
Yeah, look, for me, I mean, obviously this is my home club where I grew up, where I coach, so I'm probably a bit critical of them. I've only given them a B this year. My biggest concern with Nutterwadding is I know that they've lost their key player, the MVP of the competition, Shane McDonald, with a rib injury, and he may not be back till well after the break. But the fact of the matter is, like, I expect dominance from them. Like, every single week I expect dominance, but you know, obviously they're going to struggle with, once again, is there, you know, so much talent on this team. How do we share it around? How do we forge some sort of unity as a group so that we can, you know, share the wealth? Because, you know, Tommy Greer, Mitch Creek, Shane McDonald, Simon Connolly, you've got Andrew Steele coming in and playing bigger minutes. And even off their bench, they've got the Van Rennens, the Swanos that all just chip in and chip away. But they have to be more dominant. You know, they just have lapses in games. They give teams a sniff. And I was most disappointed to see them drop the game to Geelong at home in the fashion that they did.
Well, I think that's probably the most telling sign for Nunawading, you know, the 1-2 matchup there where they just lost it in heartbreaking fashion on the buzzer there. And it'll be interesting to see those two teams go at it in the finals, as I'm sure we will see them do. Moving on now to the next team on your list, which is the Dandenong Rangers.
This is a team on the improved, Beth. Now, they slow started, and, you know, I've given them a B this year, but we just have to keep an eye on this team because this is a ticking time bomb that's going to give some teams some real headaches down the back end of the season. Daquan Montreal is certainly an MVP candidate, and we'll talk about that in our next show later this week. But look, for me, they're a B. They've got to improve their rebounding. They've got to, you know, get on the glass a little bit more, win some extra possessions. But we're talking about a team that was the, you know, the championship winner, just hovering around 7-5. They let a few drop early, but, you know, fit Andrew Harms, and they're one step away from really pushing the best teams in the comp.
Well, again, the start of their season was injury-ridden as well, with DQ being out for the first couple of games and then Harmsy, of course, being out. Owen Ottagy coming into the team late. We had DQ on the show last week, and I think now is the time where they're really starting to get that chemistry and hit their strides a little bit more. And I think that we'll only see them continue to improve. And as you said, it's a team that did come out and win the whole thing last year after going just 14-14 in the regular season. So they're definitely a dangerous team to come up against.
They need home court advantage. And, you know, look, two teams streaking away at the top there in Geelong and Nutterwadding, they have to make sure they take care of business from here on in. They don't have any room to move.
Moving on down the list now, we come to the Ballarat Miners.
Yeah, look, I've given Ballarat Miners a B+. I think significantly better than where they were last year as a team, playing better team basketball, and found an import combination that just works. It kind of helps when you have an import like Roy Booker, who's getting player of the week performances, but certainly just takes the pressure off Anthony Fisher at times and allows Booker to come into the point guard's position. But, you know, like, we're talking about Booker a lot, but we've got to give credit to Horton. He's the leading rebounder in the competition. He's doing a wonderful job for their team, just sitting below the radar, letting Booker take all the spotlight. I really like this team. Booker, fantastic. First in assists. Not only is he scoring, he scored 3 times above 40 points this year, but he's the leading assist guy in the league right now, and that speaks volume and MVP candidacy on the horizon.
Well, I think the last 2 weeks for Ballarat We've seen them play a lot better team basketball, especially this weekend against Albury, where they had five guys in double figures. I think previous to that, when they went on their five-game winning streak, it was really Booker and Horton that were combining for the majority of their points. And now that Nathan Sobey's into the team, they're getting Anthony Fisher more involved, and they're really playing a better brand of team basketball that will see them get more wins under their belt.
Yeah, full credit to the Miners, and great to see the Miner Dome rocking, and the amount of social media that they're doing too for the Miners, that's terrific as well.
Well, moving on from Ballarat now, we come to the top team in the East Conference, both on the ladder and in your rankings, Geelong Supercats.
I have to give Geelong an A+. The best ranking in the SEABL because they've got the best record. They're 12-1. They've played good teams on their fixturing. It's not like they've played the low likes. And they've just done it in style to me. Like, there's nothing that you cry home about and say there's one guy just standing up above the rest. They just come in and get the job done. The one thing for me about Geelong, more than anything, is the tenacity defensively that they show. They just come in, they have a they have an image, they have a statement to make against teams, and it's guys like Mercer that just comes in, week out, giving them consistent contributions.
I think the key to their success so far this year has actually been Eric Gaff's introduction into the team. You know, he's someone that, you know, gets a lot of rebounds for them. I think he had 12 rebounds and 6 blocks on the weekend. But he really plays his role effectively in that team. And that's the thing about Geelong, is that every player on the team has their role and they know how to play it.
Beth, if they continue with their defensive attitude and the swagger which they've been playing at, Herbert hasn't even broken out of his shell yet. And once he gets hot, who knows? You know, the championship's going to beckon for Geelong, and I'm excited for you.
I'm excited too, Rohan. It's going to be great to see Geelong back in the postseason once again. Thanks for joining us today. Great insight into the East Conference team. Make sure you stay tuned tomorrow as we take a look at the South Conference and also a look at the MVP contenders for this year.